As the blind man was sitting there by the way, he cried to Jesus for mercy that day. Jesus commanded and gave him his sight. As he followed Jesus, I'm sure he cried, Jesus, pass by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, and when Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life when Jesus passed by. And just like that blind man, I wandered alone in the darkness of sin. I was always alone, but one day I met him, yes, and he made things right. And oh, what a difference when Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, and when Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life when Jesus passed by. Jesus passed by my way, yes, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, and when Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change in my life when Jesus passed by. Amen. And oh, what a change in my life when Jesus passed by.
James, we've been looking at James for a day, have we not? We looked over that thing yesterday a little bit, verse 26. If you'll stand, please, we'll look at this again tonight. We're going back to the first of the chapter, pick up another thought, another principle. James 1:26, God says, if any man among you seem to be religious. And yesterday, all day, we dealt with temptation, did we not? We dealt with it in verse 2, and we dealt with it in verse 12 and following. We dealt with both sides of temptation. We dealt with God trying our faith and checking us out and seeing what kind of metal we're made out of. And we also dealt with the bad temptation and how to handle that. And what did God tell us last night? How do you beat that temptation? What do you got to do?
Stay
with God. Don't leave God. Okay? Temptation's going to rise up. It's going to try to grab you. Just don't leave God and you'll make it through it. Okay? He said these words. If any man seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. So if a man seems to be religious, he ought to be able to withstand temptation on either side. Look with me, please, now, if you will, verse 3 and 4. James 1, 3 and 4. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, but let patience have a perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. You know, if any man seems to be religious, he ought to have some patience about him. Have you noticed it's running thin on some folk now? Have you noticed it don't take much button pushing to get them cranked up? You notice what the stress level's doing to everybody now? I mean, it don't take nothing to set them off. Am I right about it? You pull up too close to them at a red light and they're coming out of the car at you. Down in New Orleans, they come out shooting. They do. You dare not make any move at all in the city of New Orleans in your vehicle, because they come out of the vehicle, shoot you, get back in theirs, and drive away. Wow. They're that stressed out in knowledge. It's amazing down there. If any man seem to be religious, He ought to have some patience. Let's look at that tonight, all right? Father, help us. Lord, you know that every one of us in this room needs this thought tonight. There is just vexation on every front. And we need to be patient. We need to wait upon the Lord. We need to realize you're still on the throne. You are in control. Father, we get impatient when our lost family don't get saved. We get impatient when the boss don't give us the raise we think we deserve. We get impatient, Lord, when traffic, Lord, that 13 road is a prime example of needing patience, dear God, as they line up on that road to look at the grass or corn or whatever they're looking at. And Father, we just need patience as we drive over here every night. And so God, teach us something tonight that we didn't know. Remind us of something we did know. I pray that you'll open the hearts of the lost that's within hearing distance of this message, on the air or in this building. I pray, Father, for the open heart, for the saint. For Heavenly Father, we need our hearts opened and not closed to thine instruction. Bless, Father, Brother Jimmy and the Hood family in Columbus tonight, God, as the graduation, Father, of Miss Karen, the blessing of Miss Karen. And God, I pray for the rest that are left behind, dear God, that you'd help them and give Jimmy the wisdom he needs. And as he told me this morning, he's got some decisions and things he's got to sort out, God, and I'm asking you, God, to help him with it. And God, I pray that you just give him the wisdom he needs. Bless the church. Lord, this is the second death in the same church in a week. And God, I'm praying for Job as he probably preaches Henry's funeral, and Brother Jim as he probably preaches his wife's funeral. God, the church now does not have a first lady. They only have a pastor. And Lord, when Brother Jimmy steps down or aside, Father, then Job and Miss Angel take it, and they'll have a first lady again. But our Father, the first lady in the church is very important. For that's the one the women of the church go to and lean on. And Father, Amazing Grace doesn't have a first lady now, per se. So I'm asking you to help and bless. God in heaven, we need you tonight here. Here at Kingsway, we need a visit. Come. Let us sit at your feet and hear your words tonight. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen, my Father. Amen. You may be seated, family. If any man among you seem to be religious... Now, you know, you would think that those who say they're religious, say they have it, say they've got God, you would think they'd have patience. You would think that, but it ain't the same. Let me prove it to you by the Bible. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Huh? Come on now. The fruit of the Spirit. So a saved person ought to have some patience, sure enough. But is it not true, dear family, our patience wears thin sometimes. Sometimes we go to God and we say, Lord, I know that you're, verse 3 back in James, I know you're trying my faith, and I know that faith is working my patience, but God, hurry up and get done with this trial. Come on, I'll be honest. Nobody likes discomfort. Nobody likes discomfort. And so when discomfort comes, we want it to hurry up and get over with. We want to learn our lesson very fast. I don't know about you, loved one, but some of us are slow learners. We just don't get it right away. And sometimes God has to increase the pressure and increase the weight and put the little hit on us a little bit and help us understand that what we really need is to learn how to be patient.
Yeah.
Now, the book of James, as I told you yesterday morning in Sunday school, is a book that teaches ethics. It teaches on social manners and moral manners and it teaches you how to live a godly life and teaches you what to do per situation. And I gave you an overview of it yesterday, and I'll not go back through that again. But what I want you to understand is this. If you don't have ethics, you'll mess up. If you don't have some character about you, and listen to me real good, it's not being taught in our schools any longer. It ain't being taught in the government indoctrination schools, and it ain't being taught in the Christian schools, so-called Christian schools. Mm. It ain't being taught in college.
No.
It is not being taught to preacher boys. It's not in pastoral ethics 101. It's that class is eliminated in our churches. Mm. There are those that just go right along. That I'll give you an example. If a missionary or an evangelist, or like I am, books a meeting, and on the way to the meeting decides not to even go, mm-hmm. and just turns around and goes back home, never calls, mm-hmm. never gives word, nothing. Mm. He's unethical.
That's right.
There are things that arrive. There really are. There's things that come up. But the ethical thing to do is to call and say, "Pastor, I can't make it." And not lie about it, but give the real reason why you can't make it. "Pastor, I just ain't right with God, and I ain't coming." That's the real reason they don't come. Yeah. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
They're unethical people. Don't go to work. Don't call in. Don't let the boss know. Don't go to work. It's unethical to do that. Mm-hmm. It's unethical to say they're saved, say they have religion of some kind, size, or form, and not have some patience, and not be able to withstand temptations. Now, we all learning. Am I right about it? We're all learning.
That's right.
Babies, all right? Little babies, little fellas. That little blonde fella right there. You know what he's got? One of the things he's got to learn as a child? He's got to learn how to share. Mm-hmm. You know how sad it is for the firstborn? I'm a firstborn. I know all about it, all right? I'm a firstborn. Here comes my little brother 2.5 years later. Now, I don't remember none of this, but here comes my little brother 2.5 years later. And about the time he was 2 or 3, I had to learn how to share my stuff. It just happens in every family. In our children, all right? The boy was born, and then two or three years later, Tangie was born, and he had to learn how to share his stuff with her. That includes food. That includes toys, all right? All kinds of stuff. You got to learn. And it's ethical to learn how to share. Why? Because you're in a world not alone. You're in a world filled with people. Listen, going up Route 13, we got to share the road. Amen.
Yeah.
I about shared the road today with some guy coming out of Cortland. I about shared the road. Me and him, Raph, just about shared my front fender. Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he's going in the right lane, decides he wants to go to the left lane and pass this slow pokey. He didn't even look in the mirror. He just come out. Now, I'll be honest with you, he ain't got a brain in his head. Do you see that big truck I got? That Texas bumper? He would not have a plastic car left if he hit that truck of mine out there. Amen. But he wanted us to share the road. Amen. So I tapped the brakes and let him have his part. Hallelujah. All right? I didn't want his black paint on my white truck. Hallelujah. I was being nice. Ethics. Patience. Go to Luke chapter 8. Let's get started. No, it don't work right now. I got to get it fixed somehow. I need a big loud one's what I need. One sound like a train whistle or something. You know, I need to get one off of a semi someplace. Yeah. What I need to do, put the hammer down these guys. Of course, then I got to be responsible for the heart attacks they have. So, either way, I can't win in this business. Luke chapter 8, dear family, verse 15. Back in the parable of the sower again, I see something there in verse 15 that deals with our subject for the night. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, deceiveth his own self, his religion is vain. This man that has no patience will not bring forth fruit. I want you to look at verse 15 with me in Luke chapter 8. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. Now, there has been groups of people all around the religious world of our day that obviously have no patience when it comes to telling people about Christ. They have built great, giant, huge churches, maybe, but I don't know what's in them churches. But I'm here to tell you right now, I'll be honest with you, without conviction, there'll be no repentance, and without repentance, the people's going to perish. That's just Bible, okay? Jesus himself said, Peter said, Paul said, every one of them preached repentance.
That's right.
But there's groups of people all around us that could go down and listen. These guys are super. They really are. I wish we could get them in Ithaca for just 1 week. Get the whole city of Ithaca saved in 1 week. According to them, it can be done. Now, they don't need conviction. And they really don't need Bible. Do you want to go to heaven when you die? Yeah. Well, just say this and you can go. So they don't use Bible. And they don't use God. And they don't use the Holy Ghost. And they create a twofold child of hell out of every sinner.
Amen.
Then the next time you try to go win them to Jesus, they, well, I already got saved. So-and-so led me to God. So-and-so saved me. And that's a fact. And they're still not going to heaven.
Yeah.
So-and-so saved them, but they're still not going to heaven. I'm not going into the stories of the headbutting in 36 years of ministry I've been in, but God's Bible says that this good ground, this honest heart, this good heart, this hearing man, this keeping the Word of God fella, this guy that doesn't seem to have religion, this guy really does have God's way, he bringeth forth fruit with patience. It takes time. I'll be honest with you, love, I am more and more, the older I get and the more I'm watching the church, the more I'm looking into the church, the less I believe in first time hearing it, getting it. I'm believing more and more and more and more and more and more with everything that's going on and the way they're really listening. I believe with all of my heart there has to be some planting, there has to be some watering, and there has to be some more 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 watering before they're ever going to repent and turn to Christ.
Yeah.
Why, preacher? Why is that? Because, my dear family, I'm not seeing too many folks humble themselves before God anymore.
Yeah.
And God talks about a humble and contrite spirit and heart.
That's right.
Yeah. Such as should be saved. I'm looking at people, my dear family, that are making professions of faith and they ain't lasting one service. I'm watching people make professions of faith and they can't make the church services for 2 months. I'm watching them turn into haters of God. Are you listening to me? Turn into haters of God. You go back and visit them in months and months down the road and they don't want nothing to do with you and they'll keep their babies away from you. There's something wrong with that kind of salvation. Because it ain't salvation, family. It ain't salvation. The man that has patience will bear his fruit, will produce his fruit with patience. But if there be a man among you that seemeth to have religion, he won't be patient. He's more interested in pleasing the brethren than pleasing the Father. He's more interested in those who will look towards him of being some kind of a whatever instead of looking towards God and getting the smile of God upon his life. Gang, listen to me. I'm not going to win the whole shop to Jesus come morning. You got to witness to him and be the Christian. Listen to me. Words are becoming so cheap anymore that you've got to live more than you talk.
Amen. That's right.
Because if you don't live, ain't nothing you say can change them. They already don't want what you've got.
Right.
And you've got to let the Holy Spirit work on them slowly but surely, but slowly but surely. And you've got to be patient. Oh, it'll be frustrating. Down in the streets of Nolens years ago, way back in the 90s there, we'd see them people down there on the streets of different ones, and we'd think, my goodness, they'd be coming out. And I understand they came out for a long, long time just to eat mama's food. I know that. I'm not dumb. All right, I know why they came out there. They's hungry. And I don't blame them. Amen. She cooks for me all the time. I don't blame them a bit. Praise God. But I'm telling you, they was listening. They could hear the Word of God. And just about the time, Brother John, you thought one of them maybe just taking a little bit of a step towards Jesus. We'd come in off of a meeting somewhere. We'd always ride down through the ghetto, you know, where we worked was. We'd always ride down through the ghetto to see who was out and about, you know, at 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. And they'd see us coming up a street. Of course, there's headlights blowing on them. You know, they couldn't tell who it was exactly. So they'd do their little deal until they found out it was us. And then they was embarrassed to death. And we'd pull up and talk to them, you know, how you doing, you know, you okay. And I always told the girls, I said, I'm glad to see you alive. Because nearly every week, one of my girls got killed down in them streets.
Sure thing.
And I just tell them, I said, boy, I'm glad you're alive. I'm glad God's having mercy on you tonight, letting you live through this night. Mm-hmm. Boy, just about the time you thought, boy, they're getting it. They're really getting it. They're really getting it. Mm-hmm. We'd see them leaning up against a post down there, completely wiped out on drugs and, you know, doing their business.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, gang, you got to be patient in this fruit-bearing business. Don't expect your family to come in right away because they know you.
Yeah.
We've been 36 years working on ours, and ain't but two showed up since. Two. Two in 36 years, that's one every 18 years, for crying out loud. That ain't much, Brother Blaine. That ain't much. Two in 18 years. Two in 36 years. I'm telling you, we got to be patient. We got to wait. We got to wait on God to deal with them, and wait on God to water them again, and wait on God to draw them again, and wait on God to convict them again, and wait on God to deal with them again. And a lot of times you'll miss the conviction. See, we're becoming very good actors in our day. Hollywood has done its job in training people. I see them in newspapers and different things like that. They can play a godly somebody in one movie and an absolute pervert heathen in another. Yeah. You say, well, how do they do that?
Money.
That's all it is. Just money. They're just doing a job. That's what they do. Brother Jack Wood used to talk about John Wayne, all right? John Wayne was not John Wayne, all right? He wasn't a Marine, okay? Got that? He wasn't a fighter pilot. All right? He wasn't a cowboy. He didn't whip all the Comanches out in West Texas, okay? That didn't happen, right? He was simply an actor. Well, that's what's becoming of all of us sometimes. When we start to lose our patience with somebody, we'll put on the act. We'll pretend like we really care, and on and on and on, and all the time. Our patience is wearing thin, and we're getting angrier and angrier and angrier with those that we're trying to deal with. Go to, if you please, Luke 21, verse 19. The Bible says these words. He says, in your patience, possess ye your souls. Well, brother, what is this patience you're talking about tonight? Well, the dictionary said, it's enduring suffering without murmuring. That's what it says patience is in the dictionary. To endure suffering without murmuring. Now, I'll be honest with you. I don't know any of us that are good at this. Suffering without murmuring. I know some men that are just absolute basket cases. I ain't kidding you. God have mercy when they get sick or afflicted. I mean, they are just like little Ezra right there. Just a baby. Oh, big, tough, strong He-Man. Till they get sick. And then it's, you know, suck a thumb time. Gang, listen to me. Nobody loves suffering. Nobody enjoys suffering. But a man that's got some patience about him, a man that has some patience about him, a man that can endure this suffering without murmuring is a man that will possess control. Do you and I control our souls? Do you and I, in your patience, possess your souls? Now, we know our souls cannot ever be reattached to this body. Are you eternally saved?
Amen.
Are you forever born again? Are you forever God's child?
Amen.
Does the Holy Ghost indwell every believer? He sure does.
Yeah.
We can never be reattached to this. I rejoice in that. We have been circumcised without hands. The Holy Ghost cut us loose from this robe of flesh. That's why one of these days that soul and spirit's going home to be with God, and this is going to lay down somewhere and rot away to nothing. The battle is in there, is it not? The soul knows to do right. Right? The spirit wants to. The body don't want nothing to do with it. This thing here don't want nothing to do with obeying God. It likes fun, and more fun. It likes pleasure. It likes to feel good. It likes comfort. It don't like nothing that's discomfortable. It don't like nothing like that. It likes everything fine and dandy and soft and cushy and sweet and good. It likes all that. And this body has a tendency to try to rule. And when this body tends to take over, the soul says, wait a minute, stop. You're not the one that goes to hell if I don't get saved. You just go to a grave and rot away to nothing. Dust you are and dust you shall return. You're going back to the dirt. There ain't nothing to you, body, that's going to go for eternity. I'm going for eternity. The soul argues with the body. Mm-hmm. Come on now. But when the soul gets saved by the grace of God, now the body no longer is in control. The soul is in control now, and the soul loves God. In your patience, possess ye your souls. In your patience, control your souls. In your patience, stay in control. Why? Because your soul can declare what your body ought to do. That same hand right there that held beer bottles and none of your business now holds Bibles and the things of God. The same hand.
That's right.
The controller changed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Them boots right there, them feet right there, them feet that used to walk the honky-tonks in the streets of the world, now go to church.
Yeah.
Yeah. Same feet. 63 years old, them rascals are. Same feet. But now they don't go yonder, they go yonder. This hand don't do this, it does this. And you can take care of and control yourself. But you got to learn how to do it patiently. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be, I'm a hippie, you're not going to be a super Christian overnight. Mm-hmm. It ain't happening.
Yeah, that's right.
It ain't happening. He said, Brother Don, I need some victory. I'm giving it to you. The Bible says these words in Isaiah 26:3, "Thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee." Why? Because he trusteth in thee. Do you trust God? All right, here comes a temptation. Here comes a situation of your life. And it's trying. And it's working on you. And it's pushing your buttons. And you're near explosion. Now, what's going to explode? Your soul or your body? What's going to blow sky high? What's going to mess your testimony up? Your soul, which nobody can see but God, or this body that everybody's looking at? What's going to be heard? What's going to be heard? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. What's going to be heard out of our mouth? What the soul is saying towards God, or what the old nature is saying around man? Which one's going to be the influence? Which one's going to deal with us? Which one's going to get us out of control? If I, in my patience, possess and control my soul, here's how I do it. Soul, I'm getting mad. Lord, I'm starting to get angry about this. Lord, what I want to do is I want to lay down my Christianity for about 5 minutes and handle this dude.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the soul says, we can't do that as a testimony to Jesus Christ.
Amen. That's right. Yeah.
But Lord, he's done slapped me on one cheek, and you said when he done that, turn the other, and I ain't got but two. God says, well, I got a couple up here you can use. Calm down. Think. If any man needs some patience, the trying of your faith worketh patience. Let patience have her perfect work. What are you saying, Lord? I'm saying let the patience that's in you that you got saved, not put into you, let it work. But Lord, he's got me against the wall. And Jesus says, I'll make a way of escape. Be patient. Calm down. Let me control you. Now watch. God lays a control on me. I can use it or lose it. Listen to me close. I can take what he gives me, Devin, and I can store it in my pocket and bring it out at a more convenient time. Or I can take that control, Brother Werner, and I can use it totally in his power and take myself out of the situation patiently. Let me share two or three stories with you that are true. In the streets of America, there are times when it ain't above sinners to get right in your face, I mean right in your face, right there. Mm-hmm. I've had them in Ithaca many, many a time. I've had them in New Orleans many and many a time. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to have to get the old Don back up again to get out of this one. The old Don used to get out of them things in a little different manner than the new Don did. But the Holy Ghost would come on me and he'd say, I want you to just calm down. He said, I'm going to put some control on you and you're going to deal with this right. And the old Don's raring. The old Don's ready. The old Don's in gear and he's back up almost ready to get busy. But God takes the new Don. In your patience, possess your souls. He takes the new dawn. And I ain't kidding you. And if you think I'm a coward, that's your business. But I have talked myself out of using the old dawn to settle the discussion. Mm-hmm. Talked it out of it. Talked him out of whooping me. Mm-hmm. I told one guy one time, just a few years back, I said, you won't get any satisfaction out of whipping an old man. He said, you're not old. I said, I'm 60 plus. He said, you are? I said, yeah. And I said, what? You go bragging to your buddies how you whipped a 60-year-old man. I mean, what are they going to think? He said, well, they ain't going to think much of that. Anybody can whip a 60-year-old man. I said, that's exactly my point. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. It ain't going to do you no good to whip me out here on that sidewalk in front of everybody because you could probably do it. I got enough arthritis in that hand right there. I couldn't hurt you if I tried. So there ain't no sense to you whipping this old man. And you're just mad because of the gospel anyhow. And you can't whip God and you can't beat God. So if you don't want the trap, just don't take the trap. Don't just stand around here and cuss and raise a bunch of sand and tell me you're going to whip me out here in front of everybody because you just look like a fool whipping an old man. And he turned around and walked off. Hallelujah. I possessed my soul. I let the God part of me, listen to me close, I let the God part of me control the non-God part of me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, the old nature is the non-God.
Right. Yeah.
Have you ever thought of that? The old nature you have is the non-God part of you?
Yeah.
The old nature hates God. It don't want nothing to do with God. It rebels against God. And if you're listening to that part of you, you're going to rebel against God. But if you listen to the God part of you, you can with patience possess your soul and control yourself. Stay in control because you got a sound mind. In 1 John 3:3, staying in control gives you this great blessing. 1 John 3:3, run up there with me right quick. We'll run through this thing tonight and just see if we can get a great blessing from God out of it. Every man that hath this hope in him, what hope's that? Jesus Christ. Huh? Let's read the first couple verses. Behold, 1 John 3:1, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us so we should be called the sons of God. Have you meditated on that lately? That you're a child of God? That you're saved? Heaven bound? Can you imagine being heaven bound in the condition we're in? My goodness. Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. Look at it. Now are we the sons of God, and doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All right, because of him coming, and we're going to be just like him, every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Now let me ask you a question. When you're purifying yourself, is it immediate? Or is it a process? You're growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you doing that instantaneously, or are you doing it one little learn at a time? Yeah. I'm one little learn at a time. That's how I'm doing it. Yeah. Learn a little something every day. Learn a little something every day. You know, if any man among you seem to be religious and he don't have no patience, he's not going to be able to possess his own soul. He's not going to be able to stay in control. He doesn't have any hope that he's going to make out. And look at 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15:58, this is what God Almighty says over here. He said, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now, if you and I don't have no patience, you and I are not going to keep pressing on.
Yeah.
Am I right about it? Look at that last phrase of 58. I'm telling you, gang, you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Yeah, but God, they ain't getting saved. They ain't getting saved anywhere. You say, well, I need to see somebody saved. Well, we all would like to have that happen. But gang, listen to me. Just be patient. Just calm down. Live for God. Be faithful. Be obedient. Let God do His work. Let patience have her perfect work. Well, brother, I want them. Listen, them is not the problem. You are. You're the one. You're the saved one. You're the one that God says, let patience have her perfect work. The lost don't have patience. You're the one that needs patience. So God ain't going to dump it all on you right away because you wouldn't learn patience that way. He's going to let you watch it slowly come to pass, teaching you the patience that you need. Why? Because on down the road somewhere, you're going to need patience with somebody you ain't met yet. Yeah. You're going to need patience with somebody that you ain't going to like, you ain't going to be around, you ain't going to want nothing to do with, and you're going to have to learn how to be patient. So you learn it in the minor so you can apply it in the major.
That's right.
Come on, get it. Yeah. You learn patience in the minor so that you can put the work in the major later on. Brother, I don't know if I can take this. You can take this a lot better than you can take that.
That's coming.
It's coming. Mm-hmm. Who knows what's coming? The only thing I know for sure that's coming is Jesus.
Amen.
Thank God I'm going when He does. Who knows what's coming out of Albany? Who knows what's coming out of Ithaca?
Yeah.
Who knows what's coming out of D.C.? Yeah. Who knows what's coming out of the New World Order over Europe? Who knows? God does.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what do we got to do? Be patient.
Right. Yeah.
All that's written down in the book. Yeah. You read the Revelation, read Daniel, read Ezekiel. Everything you're seeing on the news is coming to pass in that Bible.
That's right.
Yeah. Just be patient. Endure their suffering without murmuring. In your patience, possess your souls. Stay in control. Don't lose your hope. Keep pressing on, but do it patiently. Mm. Bear fruit patiently. Go to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Are y'all out there somewhere? Yeah. If any man seem to be religious, if any man among you seem to be religious, why doesn't he have patience? God put it in us, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Romans chapter 5, 1 and following says, therefore being justified by faith. Is that you? Mm-hmm. Are you in the eyes of God just like you've never sinned at all?
Yeah.
Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you have peace with God tonight, people?
Amen.
Are you at peace with God? I preach that a lot on the street. Are you at peace with God?
Yeah.
I'm not asking if you got all your T's crossed and your I's dotted. I don't know anybody that does. My goodness, family, I don't even have all the words spelled right, let alone punctuated proper. But I got peace with God.
Yeah.
Amen.
By
whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. There's them times again. We glory in tribulations also. Why? Knowing that tribulation worketh patience. Let patience have a perfect work, James said. The trying of your faith worketh patience. Here, Romans, he says the same thing again. If you read James or Romans, you're going to have a pretty good overview of what God wants you to understand. Verse 4 says, patience. Experience, hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost which is given unto us. Tribulation worketh this patience. It causes you to calm down. It presents a container of long suffering for you. Mm-hmm. We need to become more long suffering.
Yeah.
We're too short tempered. I was talking to my brother the other week and I was trying to get him calmed down. What I was trying to do was put a fire out. That's what I was trying to do. I want you to know. I was trying to put a fire out. And I was trying to diplomatically, spiritually put a fire out. And my brother is my dad made over, and I'm my dad made over, but now I'm saved, and so now all that's gone. But I told my brother, I said, well, I said, that's good. I said, because you do have a hair trigger and a short fuse. He said, I sure do. I mean, anything, Sister Kitty, anything. I mean, boom, My dad and my brother go completely, absolutely ballistic. I mean, anything whatsoever. Any disagreement. Any disagreement. You disagree with my dad, and 1 second later, Brother John, he is up on his feet, screaming at the top of his lungs, cussing like a sailor.
Yeah.
Boom, just like that. Hair triggered and short fused. And my brother's just like him. You see what he's saying, preacher? I'm saying, if tribulation works patience, my dad or brother couldn't handle tribulation. They couldn't take it, because tribulation sets them off. But that Bible's talking to you and me.
Yeah.
We're saved people.
Yeah.
The tribulations, the trials, the difficulties, the whatevers, the vexations, the times, they help us. Lord, how much patience do I got? Do you really want to know? They used to tell us, don't pray for patience, because it always brought trouble. Remember them days?
Right.
Don't pray for patience, it'll bring trouble. Well, God said that tribulation worketh that patience. And God says, let that patience have a perfect work.
Right.
Now, nobody in their sense is going to pray for trouble. Nobody. Come on, I ain't going to. But how do you look at it? How do you combat tribulations? How do you combat troubles? How do you combat vexations? How do you deal with that which does not go your way? It ain't just the problems that's the problem. It's how you deal with it may be a problem.
Yeah.
You can't work patience if you can't stand to lose. You will never be able to survive and get you some long suffering and some patience. You'll never be able to let patience have a perfect work if you cannot stand to be opposed or lose. Have you noticed this world, how they're teaching our children in the government indoctrination stations? They're teaching them that anything goes, if that's the way they want it, that's the way it should be. They will not teach them how to lose.
No.
In the ball diamonds, the little leagues, every child ought to play ball. Well, the little duffer can't run, hit, or catch. What do you mean, play ball?
Yeah, that's good.
See, the world has been trying to teach our kids in recent years, last 20, 30 years at least, that you're not in this thing to win, you're in this thing to have fun. Well, that's not philosophy.
Right.
I mean, it's so pathetic. Can I give it to you? It is so pathetic that they created a League of Nations. Back in the early 1900s, they created a League of Nations. And what a League of Nations was everybody's equal. No matter who you are, what you was, everybody was equal. And then that turned into the United Nations. And the philosophy of everybody ought to have fun and do whatever and all that and everybody's equal has filtered off into the military system, political system, and they even got some of the great ones to believe it. MacArthur believed it, bless his heart. He didn't believe it in World War II, but he believed it in the Korean War. When they made him the Supreme Commander of the United Nations Forces. Now, I'm going to say this thing, and it's on the air, and I don't give a rip, okay? I am not United Nations. I am United States of America.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
I'm not United Nations.
That's right.
But they talked them generals into that.
Yeah.
Coalition forces.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And since Korea, we have had nothing but conflict. Dragged out, don't win, don't shoot citizens, don't hurt this, don't shoot at that church, don't shoot at this, don't shoot at that, don't want to offend anybody.
Right.
Yeah. And I'll be honest with you, it's tried some of our patience. That Bible declares that God is a God of war.
Yep.
Lord, what do I do about this situation? Go in there and kill every man, woman, boy, girl, sheep, ox, ass, chicken, duck, rattlesnake, polecat. Kill every rat you find, kill every flea you find, kill every fly you find, because if you don't, They will take you from me. And that's exactly what they've done. They took away God's people from God, and they started intermingling with the heathens. And now the diversity of it all. Listen to me. When a nation becomes mongrel, when the pure blood is gone, there is no power. Send us your multitudes. That was not a good thing, friend. That was the beginning of destruction. Mm-hmm. Now the multitudes rule America and not America.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's true. Yeah. Brother Don, I'm fixing to fight. Be patient. Mm-hmm. Jesus is still on the throne.
Amen.
He is.
He said, "You turning away from me, America?" America said, "Yep, don't need you." Mm-hmm. America said, "You will one day, I promise." And God's trying to teach you and I to be patient. Be patient. Be patient. You that are justified by faith, be patient. You that are saved, be patient. This tribulation you're going through, this stress you're going through, this economic, physical, material, mental stress you're going through, it'll work that patience. It'll bless you in your patience. Just stay calm. Just stay calm. Just stay calm. It's hard to stay calm. It's hard to watch the news and not shoot your TV out. It is. It is. It is. It is. It's hard to read the newspaper and not kick the whole stand over. Why? Because things are happening that should never have been allowed to happen. But that's how life is when people leave God. That's exactly how it is. When America left God, God Almighty says, "Is that really what you want?" And America said, "Yes." 2 Corinthians chapter 6. But I don't want you to get in all that stuff. I just study and pray and think and listen to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Listen to what God Almighty says in verse 3 and 4. He says, "Giving no offense in anything, that the ministry not be not blamed." 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3. "Giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God." And look at the very first thing Paul mentions to this church: in much patience. In much enduring this suffering without a bunch of murmuring. In much patience. In all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God. See, my dear family, without patience, you can't prove you're of God. Well, it's not God patient with you. How old is you when you got saved? How old? 22, 24, 25, 26, 31, 27. Huh? Patient God. Waiting. Waiting. Come on, stupid. Come on. Waiting. Wait. Come on, son. Come on. Come on, boy. Come on, girl. Oh, my soul. Look where they're going now. Patiently. Patiently waiting. He waited and waited and waited on us till we finally come to our senses after hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Awoke our spirit. I need God. This ain't it. I remember just before I got saved, this ain't it. This ain't it. Listen, I had a wife, two kids, and a great job. I had money. I finally had money. I was finally home every night, for crying out loud. I spent all my life away from home, driving them trucks. I was finally home every night. But this ain't it. This ain't it. Something ain't it. This ain't it. This ain't it. Something ain't it.
Yeah.
And then God moved in. And God started dealing with me. Even before the men came to my house, God was dealing with me. I just kept it a secret because I didn't know it really was God. Now I look back, I see it was God. Who else would make me sick of what I loved? Huh? Who else would make me tired of what I enjoyed? I was tired of it. I had enough of it. I was fed up with it. And then Paul Reimer and Mike Roberts comes to the house and show us Jesus Christ from Genesis to Revelation. Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. And God moved on us. And God helped us. And God blessed us. And patient God is still teaching me patience. Approve ourselves as ministers of God in much patience. In afflictions and necessities and distresses and stripes, imprisonments, and on and on and on. And you know the life of Paul. My goodness, didn't he have to be patient? How many nights did he spend in jail? Night and a day out in the deep. Can you imagine floating around in the ocean for a night and a day, not knowing what was coming up out of that water to bite you? patiently waiting on God, patiently serving God, standing in the midst of Mars Hill preaching and being attacked at Lystra and all the different things and all the different things. Finally in Rome for 2 years in his own hired house waiting patiently, patiently, patiently. He wrote Timothy and said, I'm now ready to be offered.
Yeah.
The time of my departure is at hand. Mm-hmm. I fought a good fight.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if part of his fight wrath wasn't his patience.
Mm-hmm.
He had to learn patience because he weren't going nowhere. And what he didn't see happen right away, well, you know, I mean, I'm sure it bothered him like it bothers us.
Mm-hmm.
We're so result-oriented that it's destroyed our patience.
Mm-hmm.
The big timers have preached to us, if it ain't happening in 6 months, you're a failure.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's a lie.
Yeah.
It happens on God's time.
There
are folks that need to be saved, and only God Almighty knows when it will be real.
Mm-hmm.
Our job is to tell them. Mm-hmm. Patiently, patiently tell them. And let God bring forth the fruit. Let God work in our lives. Let God do that which we cannot possibly do ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And that is introduce an invisible soul to a right now invisible Savior. See, only the Holy Ghost can do that.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't do it. You can't do it. You and I cannot convince a sinner that they even need saved.
No.
Yeah.
Try as you may. Talk to anyone you want. Go anywhere you want to go. Talk to any kind of somebody you want to talk to. You will never convince a sinner they need saved.
Mm-hmm.
But if you say, Lord, I'm talking to old Jack. And old Jack over there needs something, God, and I can't give it to him. You're going to have to work on him. And I promise you, if you just be patient with old Jack.
Now, what if you live your whole life and you don't see old Jack get in?
Mm-hmm.
Have we not witnessed to people and found out later on that they passed on and we never did see them saved?
Yeah.
There's many that have got defeated in that and discouraged in that. We knock on doors and knock on doors and knock on doors and no visitors come. And no blessings like these two don't show up. And we're just the same old, week after week after week. And our patience wears thin. We tried, Lord, why won't you do something? God says, I am. I'm teaching you patience. Is this group going home spiritual? Is this group learning the spiritual ways of God Almighty? Are you going to go home gaining rewards? Patiently talking, patiently living, patiently going. Go back to James 1. I'm going to wrap it up. James chapter 1. If any man among you seem to be religious. Well, this guy says he's saved and this guy says he loves God. Well, then why ain't he patient? Why can't he make it through tribulation? Why is it that everything's a catastrophe? Why are all molehills mountains to this guy? Because he seems to be religious. That don't make him so.
That's right.
People seem to be so-called Christian, but that don't make him so. There is emotional salvation. There is man-made salvation. There is hypocrite salvation. But there's only one Bible salvation.
That's right.
And that's true faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And man's got every kind of salvation except this one, most of them.
Yeah.
And God said, if any man seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Knowing this, that the trial of your faith worketh patience, let patience have a perfect work, that you may be perfect. Look at it, gang, as I close up. That you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. See, without patience, you're not complete. You're not whole yet. Now, I don't know about you loved ones, but I got to work on mine.
Amen.
I do. I got to work on mine.
Me too.
Mm-hmm. Why, preacher? Because the old Don wants to get up. And I got to keep that rascal down. Because he is still alive. I'll be glad for the day. Listen, Miss Karen got blessed today. You know what Karen who did today? She left old Karen behind. Yeah, she did. She left old Karen laying there in that bed. She left Karen's body laying in that bed. grabbed a brand new body with no pain, no problem, no difficulty, no more, never to die again, to go be with Jesus. Eyes that could see Jesus now. She got it.
Amen.
And she left the old Karen, that old Karen nature, she left it behind. You and I still got ours. So it's a work in process. In progress. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Lord, I'm getting vexed. Can you feel it rise up? I can feel it coming from my belt buckle. When it starts to come up on me, I can feel it. Let me guard you with some things, okay? Let me guard you with some things. I'm trying to quit and can't. Can you tell that? Don't never make decisions when you're mad, sick, or broke. Mad decisions are usually wrong ones. Sick decisions are usually out of emotion and has nothing to do with truth. And broke emotions will put you in a hole deeper than you already are in. And every one of them will work on your patience. It will rob you of your patience if you're sick, broke, or mad. Just calm down. People ask me all the time, they say, Brother Don, how do you get rid of your stress? I said, I pray. God, I'm angry. Lord, I'll be honest with you, I want to hurt somebody right now. And God, if you don't help me, I'm liable to do it. And I keep praying, Brother Warren, until I get peace. I keep praying until that patience starts to work on me. I keep praying until my God says, calm down, son. I'm in control of this, not you. 36 years, Brother John, it doesn't take near as long anymore, and I thank God for that.
Boy,
in the early years, it took me a while to get calmed down. It did. Because I had a hair trigger and short fuse. And for 36 years, God's extended my fuse and stiffened my trigger. And I praise His holy name. And He's taught me patience. He's taught me patience with the churches in the last 28 years running the road. I've been down this road started 28 years a little while ago. He's taught me patience for the church. Boy, in the early years, I expected you better toe the line and draw it right. I'm telling you, you better get right. But it takes all of us combined, year after year after year after year after year. Him on a constant, me on a once in a while to help you get to where you need to be to meet Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Boy, I used to think, boy, right? Come on, John, you should have had that already. Good night, what's wrong with you, boy? But now God says, be patient, be patient, be patient. See what happens, listen to me, when that comes in your life, you know what you're doing? You're missing their growth.
Yeah.
Stay with me now. You miss their growth. When you get impatient, you miss the things they are doing right. Watch your own kids. Devin, one of these days you have a family. Raph's got a boy. You'll say, Johan, come on, boy, come on, get it. You're supposed to get it by now. He ain't going to get it right there. Don't miss the things he does get.
Okay.
Focusing on what he ain't getting. Come on, be with me now. This big boy right here laying on the ground. Don't miss the good things he does. Focus on the things he ain't learned yet. Just be patient. Calm. Just keep teaching. Keep preaching. Keep living. Keep going. Why? Because that will let patience have her perfect work. So you may be in perfect and entire wanting nothing. The key to all of this, gang, and I'm done. It's the judgment seat of Christ.
That's right.
All of this is preparation for the judgment seat of Christ. And what we're doing, get your song, baby. What we're doing is we're just simply trying to get everybody to their place at the judgment seat of Christ. Yeah. Some are slow, some are fast, some are getting it quick, some ain't. But be patient. Let's all of us meet there at our time with what we're supposed to have. Heads bowed, eyes are closed. If any man among you seem to be religious, surely a religious man would have patience. I'm not going to ask you tonight who needs prayer for this, because everybody in here except Ezra and that little boy right there needs this. Everybody in here except Ezra and that young man right there in that red shirt needs to work on your patience. But I want to ask you this. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Preacher, I am a child of God. I have been saved. Can you raise your hand to that and testify, I have been, I belong to Jesus. Thank God for that. Bless your hearts. Bless your hearts. Father, everyone in this room needs to work on our patience, to let patience have her perfect work. Lord, I know we're too quick sometimes, and we expect too much too fast. You said tribulation worketh patience. You said the trial of our faith worketh patience. You said let patience have a perfect work, that may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. I want that. I want that for myself. When I don't feel good and everything bothers me, I want patience, God. Lord, when I ain't got no money and my mind's concerned about things that I got to pay for, give me patience. Lord, when I'm angry at the world, at myself, at my friends, give me patience. God in heaven, increase my long suffering and my temperance. It's in me. It's in the Holy Ghost. It's in me. And Father, these need it too. So I'm praying for me and them. Give us here at Kingsway tonight, members and visitors, give us patience. I pray for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Sing me verse 1.
Promises, promises,
talk
to you, and all of them true.
If you're here tonight, you know not
He's
Christ is your Lord and Savior.
He's done exactly what He said.
Come see one of us. Come see Brother Bell or one of us.
Any
of us.
Let's
take a Bible and show you how to be saved by the grace of God.
My heart
I tell you
would not be broken.
You'll never regret being
but
saved.
But He did say He'd mend it again. He didn't promise that I would never stumble.
Listen to this song.
But He did say He'd be there if I fall. And He didn't tell me He'd hear complaints I'd whisper. But He did say He'd hear me when I call. Promises, promises, and all who love them true.
Yes. Thank God.
He's done exactly what He said He would do.
Thank God.
He didn't tell me my heart would not be broken, but He did say He'd mend it again. He didn't promise my cross would not be heavy, but He did say that He my load would share.
Yes.
And He didn't tell me He'd grant my wants and wishes, but He did say He'd hear my earnest prayer. Promises,
yes,
promises,
for the God who cannot lie,
and all love them true.
Your help is in Christ.
He's done exactly what
Your
He said
is in Christ.
He would do. He didn't tell me
repent
my heart would not be broken.
Watch life.
But he did say
become a blessing.
He'd mend it again.
Thank you. We're all done, Brother.